But there were a lot of times where I felt like I couldn't share my, like, these are my parents, or like, this is their accent, and I really love Asian food. Like, why does her room always smell like Asian food, you know?
Find, no matter what someone's background is, the people that really accept you for you.
Personally, my style, I would combine it with like cozy, chic, and a little bit of street.
And also, if you like back yourself up into a corner, that's like the saddest thing. It's like, how did I not plan this out well enough, and why am I in a corner? So then you just like sit there, you're just like, questioning life. I'm like, am I planning life wrong? Like, I'm planning this fucking mopping of my living room wrong?
Hi everyone, it's Mel. Today I am getting ready for another Dear ABG shoot, and I thought I'd use this opportunity to show you my everyday makeup routine. I like to keep things very simple. I'm definitely someone who likes to spend more time in bed and less time getting ready. On my face, I pretty much have all the basics already. Put light foundation on, I have my eyebrows colored in, a little bit of mascara, and a bit of bronzer. All right, so for my eyes, I definitely struggle to find the right eyeshadow technique for my monolids, but I found it. What I typically do is I put a cream base, on my lids, and then I go in with the eyeshadow powder to really create that dimension. The palette I'm currently using is Too Faced Sweet Peach Collection. I gravitate towards, you know, peachy pinks, corals, bronzes, and I love the little puffs of purples, and you get 18 shadows here. The shadows also smell like peaches. It smells super fragrant and fruity. So the color I usually go in with is Bellini, which is this like sparkly pink color right here. So I just put my shadow brush on it. I just apply this on my lids, like directly. I feel like it gives my eyes more depth, which for a monolid, it's kind of hard to do. Yeah, so if I'm feeling extra dramatic, I'll go in with a darker brown with caramelize right here. So just a little bit right here, just for that little bit of more depth, you know? These colors are super rich and pigmented and offer true color payoff. And I think with the 18 shadows, you can really create limitless and timeless looks. So my eyes are good to go. The last thing I need to do is pop on some eyeliner and my falsies. All right, this is my final look. This is the makeup routine I use every day and if I'm shooting for Dear ABG. If you want your own Too Faced Sweet Peach eyeshadow collection or any other Too Faced products, you can use our code ABG20 for 20% off. You can click on our link in our description box. For now, I'm ready to go shoot Dear ABG. Hi everyone.
Welcome to another episode of Dear ABG, where we answer your listener submitted questions. If you don't know us already, we're a podcast called ABG Asian Boss Girl, a podcast for the modern day Asian American woman. My name is Janet.
I'm Helen.
And I'm Mel.
Before we get to your listener submitted questions, we're gonna first ask ourselves a random question. So ladies, what is a chore that you absolutely hate doing?
I hate rolling the garbage bin to the street on the cleanup day. It just feels gross and I just don't like...
I think it's fun. I don't do it for my place, I do it for my parents' place.
You wanna come over and do that? And I hate wiping down the toilet surfaces. Like, I don't mind scrubbing the toilet bowl, but wiping it down, it just gets really grimy and gross. So those two.
I do not like mopping. I don't mind vacuuming because there's some satisfaction to vacuuming where you can see things get sucked up and you can see the little barrel thing fill up with gunk and stuff, and it's like so satisfying. But with mopping, you don't know what you're actually like washing down. And especially if there's like a sticky part, you have to go over it over and over and over it again until you get the sticky part off, and it just doesn't feel as efficient. And also, if you like back yourself up into a corner, that's like the saddest thing. It's like, how did I not plan this out well enough, and why am I in a corner? So then you just like sit there, you're just like questioning life. I'm like, am I planning life wrong? Like, I'm planning this fucking mopping of my living room wrong?
That's when I just step on the parts and I kind of... I am one of those people. Yeah, if that happens, I just like tiptoe.
Oh.
And then like wipe, cover your footsteps.
I just wait there. And I'm just like,
really?
I really don't like cleaning the countertop of my bathroom because I have, if you ladies have seen my bathroom, I keep all of my like facial products out there.
That's true.
So before I can wipe down the surface, I have to wipe each individual bottle. And that pisses me off. And I know there's probably ways to solve this. I could probably get a bin or put them, you know, in a drawer or something, but I just like them like out easily accessible. And then that just means every time I clean, I have to go through the crappy exercise of wiping like 50 bottles down.
Yeah, I agree with that too, actually.
All right, so our first question comes from Jyothi from Santa Cruz, California. She said, as I enter my last quarter in undergrad in the fall, I'm graduating a little early, yay! I'm starting to reflect more on who I am and what my story is, and also maybe inspiration for personal statement ideas from med school. I realize that I identify as an Asian American, South Asian, Desi, Indian American, or just Indian, but often feel out of place in each identity group, or that I'm unable to completely fit in with each group perfectly. I guess I'm struggling to see how Indian I am or aren't, and it's hard because I grew up in the Bay Area where there were a lot of Asian Americans at school, but I still felt ostracized or out of place if I was too Indian or too American or whatever's in between. How did y'all figure out how you fit in your cultural identity? P.S. I love your podcast and your YouTube videos. It's so empowering to see Asian women be badass bosses and in control. Well,
I think for anyone who is multicultural, this is a question that goes through their heads a lot. Especially if you're a hyphenated person, you're Indian American, Chinese American, Korean American, so you're battling two different cultures and trying to figure out how to live in between and in both worlds. So for me, when I first arrived at college as a freshman, I actually tried to reject my Asianness. There's a part of me that wanted people to not typecast me as just, oh, that Asian group that's always hanging out with all those Asian people. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to be seen as an individual. So I hung out with my floor mates and it was a diverse group of people. But there were a lot of times where I felt like I couldn't share my, like, these are my parents, or like, this is their accent. And I really love Asian food. Like, why does her room always smell like Asian food, you know? So there's a part of me that felt like I was hiding that identity, and I thought I was okay with it because I was still thriving in like a college, you know, college freshman, having fun kind of a sense. And it wasn't until I joined the Chinese Students Association where I finally felt very much like I could be myself, like fully through and through without someone judging me or without someone feeling a little bit uncomfortable with what I was saying. So my advice here would be to find people who will love you for you, whether you want to talk about your Indian culture and your parents and your traditions and the foods that you eat and you just want to share that with someone, or you just want to talk to someone about just being, you know, an American girl in college as a senior. Find the groups of people that are going to make you feel like you are enough, like you are worthy, and that you deserve to be the person that you are for the beautiful complexities of who you are. And that's gonna help you out a lot in becoming comfortable with your own cultural identity.
And here at Asian Boss School, we know what it's like to feel like you're kind of a part of two cultures and then somewhat not a part of any at all. Mm-hmm. I definitely felt that growing up in a setting where I am Chinese American, but most of the people that I grew up around were, it was like a white community. And then later on when I went to college, I was surrounded by a lot of Asian American people, but because I grew up in a more white setting, I felt like I didn't quite fit in. So I'm very accustomed to that emotion or that kind of tone of feeling like you're not fully one and you're not fully the other. And I would say that, kind of like Helen said, find, no matter what someone's background is, the people that really accept you for you, right? Mm-hmm. You may not always reflect the majority of the space that you're in, but I think you can turn that into a positive, because when you're accustomed to being different than the majority, you learn to develop a greater sense of empathy for different types of experiences. So maybe try to look at it that way as well.
You know, I grew up in a pretty, like it was predominantly Asian, but it was very different types of Asian Americans where I grew up. So even for me, like, I'm Taiwanese American, there wasn't really a strong, like, Taiwanese American community where I grew up in Union City. So when I went to college, I feel like I wanted to find it. You know, I wanted to find my community. So I actually, like, was Googling, like, does UCSD have any Taiwanese American organizations? And they had two. I found a group where I felt like I connected with the people there. But I felt like I lost it when I graduated college because I was back in, like, post-grad life and I lost my community in a sense. You're about to graduate, it's gonna be hard to find your people again, right? Or just find your people in general. So I think this is where the uncomfortable will come into play, but honestly, Google like different groups of people you wanna connect with, whether it's other Asian Americans or it's other Indian Americans. I think the feeling of being alone and isolated is actually quite common, but there's a lot of groups out there now that are trying to provide that space so you don't feel alone. So if you do a little bit of research in Google for any other like groups of people that you want to connect with, I think you'll be able to find some like something. Because for me, I was able to Google like, you know, Taiwanese American like nonprofits in LA, and I found a bunch of different groups I could volunteer with or like, you know, give my time to. And I think by doing that, even though it's really awkward going to these like groups and I don't know any of these people again, here I am 22 trying to make new friends, I found a really good community organization that I really connected with. So it's never too late to find your group of people, your group of friends. So just to wrap up, I think it's okay for you to be uncomfortable again in your adulthood. I think these are moments in time where it helps you grow and kind of find yourself even more. So don't be afraid to use Google as your friend to find your groups of people.
And Jyothi, We totally understand at Asian Boss Girl how there are so many ways to be Asian American. And being Indian American is very different than being Chinese or Taiwanese American. So if you'd like to check out, we had an episode where we interviewed one of my very best friends, Drashti Gandhi. We'll show you the episode number here below. But she does talk about being Indian American, and maybe you can listen to that and feel heard and represented.
All right, everyone. So the last question for today, and this comes in the form of a text message. I didn't know people could text us, but you could text the number below. So her name is Julia, and she says, "Hi guys," smiley face with two mouths. "I really love all of your guys' fashion sense. I was wondering how you all developed your personal style, if you have any big fashion inspirations, and what your favorite stores to shop at are."
So you've probably noticed by now we have like, what, 20 Dear ABG's up now, or maybe more, somewhere around that. But you might see how we all kind of like this like monochromatic, more kind of like simple, clean look. Funnily enough, when I was younger, this was not the case. So it was really quirky in like junior high and high school, and then later on I kind of started to adjust my style to be a little bit more preppy, and I think that is highly influenced by the fact that I was working in a corporate culture. And it wasn't until I left my corporate job that I felt like I really started to find my style as an adult. I was transitioning into careers in the creative field where actually how you presented yourself and your style really spoke a lot to the type of agencies you wanted to work at. And that's when I became more interested in kind of the more classic monochromatic look. And you know, I started cutting my hair. I would get it cut and I would actually cut it myself sometimes. And that's kind of where my fashion now has evolved to be more kind of basic, clean, minimal. But I do still have a little bit of that like quirkiness that I like. So I love people like Nicole Richie. And Zoe Kravitz. I feel like they strike that kind of slightly boho but can also be classic that I really admire. And then in terms of shopping, this actually is really hard for me to answer because I haven't shopped in like over a year because of the pandemic. Maybe some people have been online shopping, but my defaults are kind of like Zara and then ASOS, influenced by these two ladies as we've purchased different things. But generally, I don't know. And I also get some stuff from like TJ Maxx or like random pieces that I find.
So I'm actually really close to my uncle and he works in fashion. Growing up, he'll always like come visit me and be like, "Honey, are you wearing the latest like low-rise jeans?" I'm just like, "No, everyone wears high-rise." And he's like, "Honey, everyone's wearing low-rise nowadays. You should try a pair." So he'll buy me all these like things that are in trend, but I always felt so awkward wearing it because when you're younger, you just wanna like blend in. I'm like, "Well, no one else is wearing it. Why do I need to wear this?" But I think having him always being like in the know and wanting me to try different things kind of started impacting me as I got older, right? Also, I spent a lot of weekends with my aunt. I was really close with her, so we'll spend a lot of weekends in San Francisco. And you know, she's really into fashion, but her style is like very like chic, but professional and sophisticated. So I would be influenced like watching her shop. Like I saw her like kind of walk on Neiman Marcus, and the way that she would touch clothing was also very different too. Like I would say thoughtful with the like with the pieces. She'll be like, she'll look, the way she observed pieces, I'm like, I would watch her and like, okay, these are things I need to learn. So I think I was really influenced by my uncle and my aunt growing up. So naturally being the mindset of like, you know, clothing, I feel like I just started asking myself, what do I like to wear? And I think personally, my style, I would combine it with like cozy, chic, and a little bit of street. I want to feel sexy and comfortable in what I wear. I do love New York street fashion. I think it's like standing blend, you know, high fashion with casual so well. In terms of stores where I shop at, I also like Janet. I don't have a favorite. I like to find really good pieces and then pair them with different things. Like if you find a really cool piece from like Topshop, but then you find other ones from like a Ross, you can make it work. So, but in terms of stores, I do shop at like Topshop, Zara, ASOS. And Uniqlo has really good basics too. They have great coats. So those are the shops I shop at.
For me, I think my fashion sense has always changed, influenced by like music videos and like, I don't know, like Britney Spears and the 90s, and I wore bell bottoms, and then I wore like super low risers and all of that, like Abercrombie, Hollister, and then Forever 21, and then into corporate, into work. Obviously I couldn't wear low risers. So I would shop a lot at like J. Crew, Banana Republic, and Taylor. I felt like I was elevating myself a little bit, you know? It's like a little bit more expensive, but you feel a lot more put together. And during those times, I remember looking at Extra Petite. She is someone that I think does it very, very well. She is someone that I think is like incredibly fashionable, and all of her clothing is more like work appropriate clothing. And she also lives in Boston. And so yeah, during the winter time, I will be taking the train to work, and I will literally wear this like big bubble jacket with like shawls and shawls on top of each other, like a freaking like Yeti walking to work, you know? I could not understand how she was able to be so fashionable and look so warm with her style. So that is highly commendable for someone to be able to do that. And then now that I'm out of that world, I have like half my closet full of work clothes and cardigans mm-hmm. and slacks that I don't wear anymore, which I am not mad about. But my favorite shops are, you know, Asian Boss Girl. But Pomofo's a good one too. Asian Boss Girl, myshopify.com. They have great pieces. Just kidding, not kidding. But I think my fashion style now is a lot just like comfort. Mm. I've been loving like the baggy shirts with like the spandex look and the crew socks and like the slip-on sandals and like a big hoop earrings and a cap or something like that. So I guess you would say that's like casual street style?
Sporty
style, yes. I'm definitely in for the sporty style. But in terms of places I shop, same as these ladies. Yes.
And this concludes this episode of Dear ABG. If you have any questions for us or want to leave us a voicemail, you can do so in the link in the description box.
And if you haven't heard already, our latest episode is up now on ABG Asian Boss Girl, and you can find us on all of your podcasting platforms. We'll catch you all in the next episode. Bye!
Wah, wah, wah. That sounds stupid. Here at Asian Boston Girl.
Boston
Girl!
Okay. And I'm actually also really close to my aunt. Yeah. I'm also really close to my aunt.
I was like, are you British or something?
Well, my aunt? That's when I said auntie, you were like, what the hell is the aunt?
Oh no, aunt's right. Okay. But aunt? I have like shawls on shawls on shawls on top of me. I'm like a fucking like